still give God thanks for all the good things. Amen? Because we know that through every day there were still good things happening. And so we have to be faithful and give God thanks for all that He has done. We also have to remember what God says about us going into 2021. That we are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession. And that we must declare the praises of Him who has called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. So stand and join us this morning as we profess we know who we are in our Lord. Amen?
am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Has ransomed me, His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died for me. Through the Son set free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God.
There's a place for me. I'm
the sun sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. And in my Father's house, there's a place. God, amen. Blessed be his name forever. His mercies are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, oh God.
Still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Circumstances and not remind God so much as remind ourselves that his promises still stand, that they are yea and amen, they are eternal, they cannot be altered or changed. Amen. Could we just sing that as the assurance of our souls? Your promises still stand.
Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness.
Father, bless your name.
Lord, I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Lord, your promise stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands.
God, thanks for that. And that's what keeps me doing what I do. Amen. And so many times when you see the circumstances of life, you feel that you want to just be silent, because sometimes you feel that there is no alignment, there's a contradiction between what you're saying and what people are experiencing. But that song reminds us that we look to God's word. Amen. And recall those things which are not as though they are. And I pray that that spirit of faith, the spirit of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit will rest upon your life, that you'll be able to look at the worst of situations and call forth those things which are not, that they may come forth and manifest in your life to the honor and glory of God the Father. Give God praise. May God continue to bless you this amazing Christmas Sunday. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. And you know, there are many promises that God has given to the children of Israel. And we can also take stake in those and also remind him of those promises for us. One such promise is written in Isaiah chapter 54. And this is the eternal covenant of peace. And it says, sing, O barren one who did not bear. Break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who have not been a neighbor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than the children of the one who is married, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent, and let the curtains of your habitation be stretched out. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords and strengthen your stakes. For you will spread abroad to the right and to the left, and your offsprings will possess the nation and will people the desolated cities. Fear not, for you will not be ashamed. Be not confounded, for you will not be disgraced. For you will not forget the shame of your youth and the reproach of your widowhood. You will remember no more. For your Maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. And the Holy One of Israel is your Redeemer. And the God of the whole earth he is called. For the Lord has called you like a wife deserted and grieved in spirit. Like a wife of youth when she is cast off, says you, Lord. For a brief moment I deserted you, but with great compassion I will gather you. Amen. In overflowing anger for a moment I hid my face from you. But this is God's promise. He said, with everlasting love I will have compassion on you, says the Lord your Redeemer. And then going down to verse 11, it says, O afflicted one, storm-tossed and not comforted, behold, I will set your stones in antimony and lay your foundations with sapphires. I will make your pinnacles of gate and your gates of carbuncles and all your walls of precious stones. And verse 13 says, all your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. For those of us who are concerned about our children, it says that our children will be taught by the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. Amen. In verse 14, it said, in righteousness you shall be established. You shall be far from oppression, for you shall not fear, and from terror from it will not come near you. Amen. So you are reminded that you shall not fear, because terror will not come near you. And then the last part I want to remind us is in verse 17. Well, I guess I should start from verse 16. It says, behold, I have created a smith who blows the fire of coals and produce a weapon for its purpose. I have also created the ravager to destroy. Because verse 17 said that no weapon that is fashioned against you shall succeed. And you shall refute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, declares the Lord. So the Lord has given us many promises. Yes. And so his promises still stand, as that song said. And our God is a faithful God. And so whatever we've been believing God for in 2020, the year has not come to an end as yet, but we can continue to trust God and believe God. Believe that all of his promises are yea and amen. And we can stand on the promises of Christ our Savior, leaning on his everlasting arms. So we thank you, God, for your promises. We thank you, O God, that there are so many of them written in your word. And we can continue to remind ourselves of those promises, because they were spoken by you and they will come to pass. We will remain faithful, O God, as we continue to stand fast, as we continue to trust, as we continue to remind ourselves of your yea and your amen, O God. And we thank you, O God, that you have kept one promise, O God. That is a promise to give us peace, O God. That is a promise, O God, to overshadow us with your love. And that is the promise of your Son, Jesus Christ. He came to this earth, a humble lamb, a baby, O God, born in a manger. O God, he did not stay small, but he died, O God, for the purpose of our sins. And because of that, we are able to come before you today, exalting your holy name and giving you your praises. Because indeed, great is your faithfulness to us, O God. And we proclaim today, O God, that we will also be faithful, O God, because you have been faithful to us. And we continue to trust in you and lean upon your everlasting arms. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Could you give the Lord a hand? That's one of the things, because God says he's the only God that can predict something before it happens, that just in one place alone we have so many incredible promises that you can make personal to your life. And there are so many, many more. Could you lift up your Bibles all over this room as we get ready to do our declaration? I'm going to ask the choir to stay until we are done. And then we're going to get right into the words of God. We thank God for how he has brought us through 2020. It's been an amazing year, and he's blessed us beyond our wildest dreams. If you only count blessings in terms of material things, you would have missed the move of God. But God was present with us all along. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. He said, I will remain. Say with me, I will what? Remain. Hallelujah. Could we say that again? I will what? Remain. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I will remain with you unto the end of your days. I give God thanks for that amazing promise that even the darkest of days, when I don't discern him, when I feel he has left me, I hold on to his word that promised me that he is still there. He is still there. Amen. Glory to God. I may not feel him, but I know because of his word that he is still there. He remains with me. And nothing in this world can ever separate me from the love of God. Amen. There's days when I've disappointed him. There's days when I've let him down. There's days when I was ashamed of myself. Didn't even want to come and see him because I didn't know how he would receive me. I was like the prodigal son debating about whether I'll make my way home. But God embraced me with his everlasting love. He was excited to see me when I didn't deserve for him to receive me. Can someone give the Lord a praise? Do you know what I'm talking about? Amen. Glory to God. Because his promises stand, they are yea and amen. He says, I've loved you with an everlasting love. I've loved you with an everlasting love. Blessed be his name forever. Can someone give the Lord a praise? Glory to God. Yes, I feel the anointing of God all over this room. Yay. The everlasting love of God. Glory to God. From beginning to end, his life story speaks of love. Amen. So could you say with me with confidence, this is my Bible? Based on Psalms 138. Say with me again, this is what? This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today I'll be taught the word of God. I boldly confess. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I will never be the same. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I will never be the same. Do you believe it? Wave your Bible, make the devil mad, say never, never, never. I'll never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I will never be the same. Whoa. You know, I believe, you may be seated. You are such a nice audience. Wow. I was starting to go right into my sermon and you guys will be still standing. I favor you. That was so special. The reverence and the respect you have for God's word and for his servants to remain standing until you ask to sit. I really was moved by that. That was a great moment. Today I want to speak to you about give God your grief and he will give you his joy. And we're concluding our sermon series, The Gift Exchange, which is an amazing practice during the Christmas season. I can assure you that most people, especially in this season, when we are hemmed in by limitations, that one of the ways for us to still give, for us to still express the Christmas season, is to participate in the gift exchange. You may not be able to have bought gifts for everybody, but as a community and as a family, we can buy gifts for each other and share the love that God has placed in our hearts, one for the other. And we give God thanks for that. I want to honor God for all of the people he brought into my life. He brought them in unusual ways. And he's been just growing and building my family in ways I could never anticipate or imagine. And everyone that has come into my family has made it so much better. I give God praise. Could you help me celebrate God for my family? Amen. Glory to God. Amen. I remember a man that was like Napoleon meeting me when he came to our financial peace. Brother James was helping me teach. And he looked at me, he said, I wanted to see the man for whom many of my family have left the Methodist Church to be a part of it. He said, but you know, I'm Methodist. I will never change. And I smiled because today, not only is he a part of Living Hope Cathedral, but he wanted to be so much like Mike. He married my wife's sister. And when I called him brother, I meant it in every sense of the word. Brother Craig Matthias, could you give him a hand? Amen. And I must say that since he's married into my family, he's gotten better looking. We live like that. I could tease him. And he hosted an amazing breakfast at his house, and I give God thanks for that. You know, for another man to invite you over to cook you waffles, to ask you how you want your omelets, to hide away a little special salmon and put salmon in my omelet for me, that's amazing. Amen. Could you give Craig a hand for making my Christmas special? Craig and Rhonda Matthias, this special agent from Tortola, is now a part of my life. I give God thanks for my daughter-in-laws. Their laughter fills my home and their friends. And I give God thanks for how my family is growing and evolving in ways I will never imagine. That there's so many special people from all over the world that have become part of my family. And I've made room in my heart to love them all. And they've made my life special. And today I say that that is one of the most amazing things about this Christmas. And at Reba's office, we decided to do they call it the white elephant, the gift exchange. How many of you have done that? And this time it was a little different. Before, when we did it in America, you'll be able to open your gift if you go under the tree first. You pull a number and then you pick a gift. You get to unwrap it. And then if you want that person's gift, you can steal it about 2, 3, 4 times, whatever the rules admit, until the last gift is taken from the tree. Then it's like musical chairs. When the last gift is opened, then whatever gift you ended up with, you're left with. Okay? And so we did some of that, and that was amazing. But this time, they added a little spice to it. When you pick up the gift from underneath the tree, you couldn't unwrap it. So it was still a mystery in your hand. And do you know, regardless of how many years I've played this game, I still fall for the pretty paper. I like big things, so my dogs are big. I fall for the big boxes and the pretty paper. And good things come in small packages. And also, good things are not sometimes the best wrapped. Say, that's me. Yeah, that's me. I may not be the best wrapped, I may not be the biggest thing, but, you know, I'm special. And special things come in small packages. And so I always fighting to end up with a big box that was prettily wrapped. And I wouldn't tell you what I got. But I'll tell you about my other two gifts, because I'm wondering if it sends me a message. And for all of you who have the spirit of discernment, I activate the spirit of discernment on your life. For my birthday, I got a perfume, cologne, right? That's what you call mints. Cologne is right. Okay, not toilet water. I've seen that in some bottles. So I got a cologne, and it was a cologne called Boucheron. It was French, and it means butcher. Odd, butcher has a nice smell. I said, oh, butcher, what are they trying to say? Butcher. Well, I accepted that, but that was like November 24th. And then this Christmas, they gave me another cologne. Say, another cologne. And this time, they gave me a cologne that says Savage. So when you put those two colognes together, you get Savage Butcher. And I'm trying to figure out what's the message in that. And so if you have the gift of discernment, can you help me? Can you just pull me aside at the end and say, Pastor, they're sending you a subliminal message, and this is what they're trying to say to you. And if you can help me out, I'll give God praise for you for being a part of our lives and part of the church. And so now I return to Psalms 31 and 12 because I want to share with you about the fact that when God enters into a gift exchange with us, he takes from us things that are so far worse and gives us things that are amazingly better. And that's what he wants to do today. And I want to start with King David, because King David is saying a prayer and he's making a statement that most of us can identify with in 2020. He said, I will praise you, O Lord. I will exalt you, for you have rescued me. You refuse. I just like that word. I got stuck on that. You know, when someone is relentless, and this is what David says. He says, you refuse to let my enemies triumph over me. He refused to let it go the way they wanted to go. Say with me, refuse. Refuse. God refused to let my enemies triumph over me. Oh man, I got lost in that. I got up and I just started worshiping. You know, sometimes you want to say, let it be. You want to resign yourself to certain outcomes. But even as you are resigning yourself to certain outcomes, the sovereign Lord refuses. Hallelujah. And that gave me joy. When you want to say, God, you know, let it go. I've wanted this for so long. What will be, que sera, sera. God says, no, I refuse because my promises stand. Blessed be his name forever. Glory to God. And I got excited by the fact that even when I want to quit and give in, God refuses. Hallelujah. For my sake. Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor, God refuse. Say with me, God refuse. Say with me again, God refuse. Hey, that's going to hit you in the middle of the week. God refuse. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name forever. And that one word made me excited. That for all that has been going on in 2020, they say, well, this is the new normal. This is the way it's going to be. Hallelujah. That God in heaven says, I know the plans and the purposes I have for your life. And I refuse, hallelujah, hallelujah, I refuse to let the pandemic triumph over you. I refuse to let COVID-19 triumph over you. I refuse to let financial failure triumph over you. I refuse to let your marriage end in failure. I refuse, I refuse, I refuse, hallelujah. Blessed be his name forever. Glory to God. I feel the anointed on that word, because there's so many times I wanted to give in with tears. I told God, let it go the way that it is going. I refuse to fight any longer. But God stood up on the inside of me. Glory to God. He said, no, Rich, no, Rich, this is not your fight to concede. This is not your fight to give in. This is not your fight to quit. I refuse for the integrity of my name. I refuse. I refuse to let your enemies gloat over you. I refuse to let your enemies rejoice over you. I have plans for you that no man can alter or change. Can someone stand up and give God praise? Say, God refuses. Hallelujah. Yes, that's what he does. That's what he does. He refuses. He refuses. He refuses. Blessed be his name forever. Glory to God. And 2020 came to rewrite my story, but God refused. Glory to God. It spoke into my heart of anxiety, of fear. It pushed me on the brink of losing my mind, but God refused. Woo. That's why we're here in Christmas, 7 days away from 2021, because God says, I have preserved you because I have plans for you. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name forever. God's plans include me. He won't allow me to shut up or be defeated. He won't allow my enemies to gloat or rejoice over me. He said, they don't have the last word because I refuse. Blessed be his name forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Say, God refuse. I feel it. God refuse. You don't have no say. He took divine authority. He said, I've made you a promise and I'm keeping my word. You don't get to concede and tell God what he's going to do in your life. You don't get to tell him that it's enough. I'm tired of fighting. I'm tired of holding on. Because even when you give up, God refuses. Woo, God refuses. And there ain't even the sermon. But I feel anointed to tell someone regardless of how your life looks now, regardless of how people are trying to rewrite your end and rewrite your story, God refuses. Blessed be his name forever. Glory to God. You may be seated if you can. God refuses. He knows those who hate me. He knows those who gets activated with their scandal and their gossip when my life isn't turning out too pretty. And he refuses to let my enemies triumph over me. Glory to God. You don't know how many times I wanted to take the side exit from off the stage. You don't know how many times people have met me and told me, what does it mean, Pastor, when you're serving God and preaching God and he allows you to lose your home and your ministry? What does it mean? I don't know. You think God is punishing you? I don't know. But I've looked at my life. I'm still here, 2020, still preaching the good news of Jesus the Christ. I'm still preaching because God refused. I showed up at Assembly of God with dirty sneakers and unironed jeans and a crumpled shirt. And they put me to preach because God refused. I told him I was done, but God refused. That's what he did. Blessed be his name forever. God refused. When I was thrown down, God refused. When my strength failed, God refused. And that word just stuck in my spirit. Yet I've come to preach to you about joy. But I want it to resonate in your spirit like it did in mine. Woo! God refused to let my enemies triumph over me. You know, David is writing this in a bad place. He's writing this when he's been anointed to be king, but everything else in his life says otherwise. He's writing this from caves, running to and fro on the earth, hiding from powerful men, even as the Lord Jesus Christ himself. But here's what he says. He says, "O Lord, my God, I cry to you for help. I pray to you. And you restored my health. You brought me up from the grave, O Lord. You kept me from slipping and falling into the pit of death. Sing to the Lord, all you godly ones. Praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may last through the night, but joy comes with the morning." You know, when I was prosperous, David speaking, he said, I said, nothing can stop me now. Sound like a song. Nothing can stop me now. Your favor, Lord, made me as secure as a mountain. Then you turned away from me, and I was shattered. I cried out to you, O Lord. I begged the Lord for mercy, saying, what will you gain if I die? If I sink into the grave, can my dust praise you? Can it tell of your faithfulness? Hear me, Lord, and have mercy on me. Help me, O Lord. And then verse 11, seeing that God answered his prayers because he came back and he finished this desperate cry for help. He says, you have turned my mourning into joyful dance. You have taken away my clothes of mourning and clothed me with joy, that I might sing praises to you and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give you praise or thanks forever. So now for the real sermon that's on my heart. You can give God your grief, your sorrow, your pain, your loss that came into your life on the heels of 2020, because God promises, say with me, he does what? He promises to give you joy. What an amazing exchange. You know, joy has always been associated with the coming of Jesus the Christ, God who became flesh and he lived among us. The Gospel of John chapter 1. And the angel said to them, do not be afraid, do not be alarmed, do not be concerned. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Luke chapter 2 verse 10. I have no doubt that in 2020, we were all faced with unprecedented circumstances. No one is exempt. I actually pray for the pastors of mega churches who has enormous budgets and their pews are empty. I feel the weight and the frustration and the concern on their hearts as they try to respond to the times that are upon us that has brought so much grief and loss into the lives of many people. But God sent Jesus into the world, and it is cause for much excitement, because when Jesus came into the world, the heavenly host exclaimed that he would be the source of good news that will cause great joy for all people. God sent Jesus into your life and into my life so that he may cause us joy. This side of eternity, grief is a reality. We suffer loss of loved ones through death, separation. If you live long at all, you will experience grief, pain, and loss. And here's King David, who's lost so much in his life. If you will follow the life of King David, a man of God's own heart, you'll find that even people that God loves suffer loss. He lost his best friend, Jonathan. He actually said he loved Jonathan better than a man loves a woman, because he was his good friend. And people reflected and write so much about it, but he meant that Jonathan was close to his heart. Jonathan was actually the brother of Michael, his first wife. And Jonathan loved David with a loyalty that could not be severed. He lost Michael's love because she left David for someone else. She actually began to hate and scorn him because he was a shepherd boy wearing king's garments. And he didn't know how to behave. He didn't understand protocol. He didn't have any decorum. And so when he began to worship God, he worshiped God how he worshiped him in a field when no one was around him. The Bible says he began to dance with such exuberance. And so when he talks about joyful dance, he's talking about dance that has energy, vibrance. He said that his mourning will be turned into joyful dance. He's reflecting about the time when he danced, when the presence of God. Why did I say the presence of God was coming back in the midst of Jerusalem? The Bible said he danced loose his clothes, his kingly garments. And his wife looked at him, and she despised him. Where did she despise him? In her heart. What did she despise him for? For worshiping God unafraid. And do you know that that is still the handicap of so many people who want to sing and worship God and dance before God? We are so concerned about what other people is going to think about us when they leave this space. But I pray that the joy of God will so flood your heart that you would dance. Glory to God. Can I say that again? And I'm not blaspheming. I pray that the joy of God will so hit your heart that you can dance. There's been very few times in life that I have danced. I'm not a dancer. I'm not given over to dancing, because the obvious truth is I'm not good at it. I actually envy people who can dance. Do you know that? Because God gave me a lot of gifts. One of them is this. I can speak to you. I can entertain you. Jokes flood out of me even when I'm not trying to be funny. But dancing, I look like a handicap. I look like my feet are pinned on wrong. And one of the things that mesmerized me about this church girl, I'm a church boy, Reva, is that she was so conservative and she was so many other things. But when we were at UVI one time, music played, and we were walking up the hill, you know, Lady in Red, dancing with me cheek to cheek, and she started dancing next to me. And just the way she was swaying, I like, oh man, she got movement. She has, the girl can dance. Don't let Pastor Reva come up here reading long verses, throw you off. The girl can dance. Can we give the Lord a hand for the dancers? But the church has ruined us in making us think that if you dance, you are worldly, you're fleshly. But David danced before God. And what matters is what's in your heart. when you dance. Are you hearing me? What matters is what's in your heart when you dance. And I remembered when Romani got married, I thought, these young people, they act so crazy. But you know, I got so happy, I danced. And it didn't matter that my feet was not doing it right. It didn't matter I was making up my own moves. It didn't matter. I was expressing something deep from within my spirit because my heart was overwhelmed with great joy. And because my heart was full of joy, the only way that I can express myself was to dance. And David is saying that God can take your worst moments and turn it into an opportunity for joyful dance. Can someone give the Lord a praise? You may not feel it now, but God says, I can take your moments of mourning and turn it into joyful dance. Can someone lift their hands and say, do it, Jesus. Do it, Jesus. And I'm not only talking about in the privacy of my bedroom, but teach my feet to dance. As I come out of the season of grief and loss and pain and despair, help me to experience joyful dance, even as David encouraged us in Psalms 30. And he shows his reasons for being joyful. He shows his reason for giving God thanks. And here's what he says. He says, God has rescued him from his enemies. How many of you know that God has rescued us in 2020? God has rescued us. No amount of hiding. COVID was like a heat bomb. It was searching you out. People gone and hiding under their blankets, and COVID will find you right under your sheets. This thing was amazing. Sometimes it makes you believe in biological warfare, that something can leave China, do minimal damage in China, and go to the rest of the world and have us in a panic. How did the COVID-19 know to kill less people where it came from and just terrorize the rest of the world? And how did COVID-19 know to find me here in St. Thomas? For sure, when I was reading it all the way in China, I was happy. I was a happy boy. I said, there's no way you're going to cross these seas. Foolish me. Next thing you know, COVID off the coast of the Virgin Islands. And then the next thing you know, it's right here. Next thing you know, COVID got you watching everybody with a jaundiced eye. You know it's you too. All of you think Pastor Carl looked clean. He looked innocent. As soon as I come around here, I see you pulling up your mask. What are you doing that for? I tease them. Do I look like I have COVID to you sometimes? My family came visit me last night, and they came into my house, and they put on their mask. I said, look at you coming. But they did the right thing. Give them a hand for doing that. But what I'm saying to you is that all of a sudden, we didn't even trust what was normal. We didn't trust the places we go. We didn't even trust our relatives and friends. We began to understand that it could be anywhere and everywhere. And the only person who has kept us to this day is Jesus. It's Jesus. God rescued us. He rescued those of us who didn't have it. But you know what's even amazing? Just like the Hebrew boys in the fiery furnace, he rescued those of us who got it. What an amazing God. It didn't matter to him either way. You didn't have it, he was protecting you. You got it, and he delivered you. God rescued us. Can someone give the Lord a hand? The Lord God rescued us. Hallelujah. And people have been waiting with bated breath for vaccines, I see. I have been vaccinated already. I'm waiting for two, but I'm waiting for the right one. I like the fact that I go for two shots and all of that. I'm saying for us to return to normal, we're going to have to be vaccinated. But do your homework and follow the big boys. Who did I say? Follow the big boys. I like Pfizer. Pfizer has a good name. The stock is going up. It's amazing. But I was looking at Dr. Fauci. Fauci. He has a nice name, Fauci. Sounds Italian. Dr. Fauci. So when the Pfizer come out and everybody was running to get Pfizer so they could put on Facebook that they were the first ones in every jurisdiction getting it, I said, good for you. You can be my hero. I ain't being first in line. I'm sorry. I'll get there eventually. But this ain't one of those times I want to be first. If you're sharing out sweet bread, I might be first in line. but not for no vaccine. Jesus, help me. My wife is praying for me all now. She believes in science and I believe in common sense. I ain't being the first. Common sense has kept me alive, not medical sense. And I watching, and I reading about every allergic reaction. I want to know if you had my genes. Were you related? Richardson? Fleming? No. Okay, good, really good. I'm still in line. So then they start asking our brilliant doctor, why haven't you taken it? And he gives some reason. You know, they have to be so politically correct. And then several days later, I even sent it to my wife by email. Dr. Fauci? One name I want to give him. Make up your mind. You see how I take my fault and put it on you? Just like a good marriage. I've had 27 years of practice. So the top doc, that's a good way to say it, James. Who's the top doc? They'll have to talk. So the top doc, he finally got the vaccine. Everyone knew that? Yeah. And he got Moderna. I'm not going to med school again, Reba. Moderna. And I said to Reba, tongue in cheek, LOL, that's the one I'm getting. And I know eventually we're all going to have to get it. I know for purposes, they're not going to tell you which one is better than the next. But I say to you, be wise, do your homework. But what I've always marveled at, as I spend my days in prayer, I've given no one else glory, praise, and worship except the God of heaven. Are you hearing me? Except the God of heaven. Because he has rescued us. And if you feel that way about him, could you give the Lord a hand? Glory to God. Glory to God. And one of the things he's shown me is how fragile all of the systems we're built for our security are. All of the systems are. How fragile they are. Even down to our government systems, since we have to continue to pray for our leaders and our governments and our presidents. We have to pray for the outgoing president. We have to pray for the incoming president. But one of the things that shows how fragile we are, when they, who has a $21 trillion dollar budget is fighting over the size of your stimulus check, it tells me that money is limited regardless how big your pocket. And so stop letting them speak of consumer confidence and having you spend what you don't have during Christmas, because even the U.S. government has to have fights and debates about how much they're going to spend. Are you hearing me? Yeah. Did that make sense? Uh-huh. And you with your little budget figure you got no restraint because you're going to help the economy. Even them have debates, whether your check is going to be $200, $600, or $1,200, because what countries are realizing is they don't have the capacity to continue to take care of their people endlessly. But there's only one person who's promised that, and his name is God. In fact, it is engraved in who he is. He made it his name, so that when he made a covenant with you, he says, this is who I am. Yahweh or Jehovah Jireh is my name. The Lord who provides. Give the Lord a hand. The Lord who provides. And if you've been trusting on anybody else, you're gonna feel a little pinch. But if you're trusting in God, he will meet all your needs according to his riches in glory. David said he's going to rescue you from your enemies. He restores your health. He brought you up from the grave, and he kept him from falling into the pit of death. He was walking on the edge of death, but God did not allow him to die. He said, he has taken away my grief, and he's turned my mourning, he's turned my loss, he's turned my pain, he's turned my tragic moments into joyful dance. And he's clothed me with joy. This Christmas, I believe that God wants to exchange joy for your grief, your pain and your loss, as you've endured many, many challenges. And the truth be told, some of our greatest challenges didn't come out of the COVID-19 pandemic. Some of our challenges came out of our personal lives. And we felt pain about it, and we've been silent about it, but it's real. And when you give God your grief, he promises you to give you joy. In Isaiah 61, there was a prophecy concerning the Lord Jesus Christ, and that is why the angels spoke so well about him, that the good news of the Messiah, the good news of Jesus, will cause many people to experience joy. And this is what Isaiah speaks about the Anointed One, the Lord Jesus Christ. He said he's going to take away some things from you. He's going to give you other things in their place. Jesus Christ, the promised Messiah, exchanges things that are bad, things that are unwanted, undesirable in your life, for things that are absolutely amazing, that money cannot buy. He prophesied that when Jesus comes, he will replace your ashes. Ashes speaks of shame, speaks of condemnation. He said that he will give you in exchange a crown of beauty. He said he's going to replace your despair and he will give you hope. He's going to replace your fear with encouragement. You don't have to be afraid. And he speaks of, I will replace your sorrow or your mourning for everlasting joy. Joy that lasts. Isaiah 61 verses 2 through 7, the New Living Translation. And the angels declared that when Jesus was born, that the good news about Jesus, the good news that we preach and we share and we witness about, will cause great joy to all people. God, through Jesus, will give people joy that they cannot get from China, cannot get from Pandora. Listen, Pandora got the best business. Can someone get me a franchise? In St. Thomas, most of the gifts under the tree came from Pandora. That wasn't a multiple choice. I got that right. And the church say, amen. Oh, you don't want to say amen because you did it too. You can't find room to go into the Pandora. They were the only ones that was open in Haven Site and on Main Street. Pandora. What does it mean? But God says, I'm going to give you something that doesn't come in a small little box. It is not made of sterling silver or yellow gold. I'm going to take away from you your mourning, your pain, your loss. And I'm going to give you something that lasts. Say something that does what? Lasts. Glory to God. It's not just going to last for a day. It's not going to last for 2 days. I'm going to give you something that lasts, and he calls it everlasting joy. If you want everlasting joy, Jesus is saying you can have it. I'm giving it to you. And it was spoken of me before I was born. You see, joy is a divine dimension. It is not happiness. It's not happenstance. It's not based on whether people love you back. It's not based on whether you got the gift that you wanted for Christmas. It's based on the fact that God loves you with an everlasting love and nothing would change his mind. Isn't that amazing? That God loves you and me with an everlasting love and nothing will change his mind. One of the greatest obstacles to salvation is people telling you that they don't deserve God's love. It's one of the greatest debates that you tell people how much God loves them and how he sent his world into the world to die for their sins. They're saying, not me, Pastor. I know that God can save anybody, but not me, Pastor. I've done some terrible things. I'm not deserving to be loved that way. And nothing could ever change God's mind about the way he loves you. Isn't that amazing? He calls it a dimension of joy that comes from knowing that you are loved with an everlasting love. And nothing could change God's mind. He looked at humanity through the ages. He saved us during the flood. He saw our sin, our shame, our idolatry, our hatred, our enmity against God. And Jesus still came into a hostile world to lay down his lives for the sins of Carl Ambrose Richardson. And I was not yet born. God loved me. And he desired for me to experience his love and his peace and his everlasting salvation, because joy is at the heart of God. It is actually a divine dimension. And so many of us exclude ourselves from experiencing joy because we exclude ourselves from the presence of God, joy that gives strength to us. And that is what Paul says, that let the joy of the Lord be your strength. I say rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. He's telling that for some reason, because joy has a divine dimension. Say with me, what? A divine dimension. And joy comes from being in the presence of God. Because in his presence, there is what? Full expression of joy. Isn't it amazing that the one thing that seems to invade the world is because we are busy running from God, in whose presence there's a full expression of joy. And we wonder why we are hurting, feel so much pain, depression, rejection, loneliness, and being unloved. Because we are avoiding the presence of the one who changes all of that. In Zephaniah 3:17, King James Version, I just want to share some scriptures with you. And after the end of my sermon, I'm going to ask Sister Kendra to come, because I feel led of God to have a prayer over the church and over our hearts and over your life. I really believe that 2021 is amazing, but even as I say that to you, I also say to you by great witness, 2020 was amazing. Can someone give the Lord a hand? You may not see it, but 2020 was amazing. Don't let the pandemic blind you to the amazing love and faithfulness of your God. 2020 was amazing here. God did great things for us, and we are glad. But 2021, based on the world's view and perspective, is going to be even better. I believe that in my heart. In Zephaniah 3:17 says, the Lord your God is with you. The Lord your God is with you. The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to what? Save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice or will joy over you with singing. God sings. Wow. And we thought Lucifer was the chief of worship. God created him to worship because God sings. And the amazing thing is that God is a lover. And God sings over you. And he quiets you with his love. I pray that there will be seasons when you walk in the midst of great darkness and you cannot see with your eyes where the Lord is leading you, that you will tune in with the ears of your spirit and you can hear the love of God singing over your life, reminding you how great and amazing you are, that you are fashioned in the image of God and how he loves you. Oh, how he loves you. And the Bible says he sings to you. And singing is an expression of love. I tell you, I envy people like Brother Corbett. Boy, if I could sing like Terrence, Reba would love me 10 times as stronger than she loves me now. Because every time I move to sing to Reba, she laughs. When I'm feeling deep, strong emotions for Reba, I try to sing. There's a YouTube song, I'm not going to tell you. I love to sing that song. When I'm feeling blue, all I have to do is take a look at you. Oh, now she's laughing. And I'm feeling so much emotion in my soul. Why? Because, like God, I try to sing, but I'm off key. But can someone tell Reva, when someone is singing to you in love, you don't laugh? When God promised me that he will raise up in this church an amazing worship team, I knew it was going to be a miracle. Because as a pastor, I love to sing. And I love to worship, but it's not my gift. So I'm going to stay in my lane this morning and stop burdening you with the love that I sing with from my heart. And that's my favorite song, one of my favorite songs. All I have to do is take a look at you. And I want you to know that God has been quieting us with his love. He's been singing over you in 2020. Have you heard his voice? Yes. Could you give the Lord a hand for singing over your life? Singing over your life. Glory to God. Give him a better hand. He's been singing over your life. Singing over your life. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He's been taking away the anxiety and the fear, because he's been singing over me with his love. And he's been expressing the fullness of his joy over me. In Luke 10:21, Jesus says that he was full with the joy of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not just given to us to speak in tongues and to have revelation and to see miracles and to prophesy. One of the things that the Spirit of God was given to us to experience is joy. Say with me, joy. In Psalm 16:11, David writes about the source of his delight. He says, you will fill me with joy in your presence. And Jesus taught us in the Gospel of John 15, 10 and 11, if you keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I've kept my Father's commandments, and I've stayed in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. He wants us to have fullness of joy, everlasting joy, overwhelming joy. That's what he came into the world to give us, not just a taste of joy, but a joy that lasts, a joy that overwhelms us, a joy that makes us sing in the midst of dark, dire circumstances, and a joy that causes us with the thanksgiving and praise of God in our hearts to look up. To do what? To look up. Glory to God. That's what praise will do. It will reorient your vision from your circumstances and cause you to look up to the great and eternal God and join in his singing because he's faithful. Hallelujah. Father God, we love you. Glory to God. We express our love in our hearts for you. You're an amazing God. You're an amazing God. Preaching sermons like this will make you stop and worship because I'm overwhelmed by that. He didn't just come for us to have some joy. He came for us to have the full expression of joy. And he came so that those of us who feel far away, feel disconnected, feel alienated, those of us who feel alone, feel shut out, feel disconnected, feel severed and separated, will be drawn to him as we search for him. Because he says, when you find me, you will find joy. Turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew 2 and 9. Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judah in the days of Herod the king, behold, there was wise men. They came from the far east, and they came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we've seen his star in the east, and we've come to worship him. We've come to do what? Worship him. Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, he determined from them what time the star had appeared. And then he sent them to Bethlehem because his advisors remember what was written in the book of Micah. And he says, go and search carefully. Do what? Search carefully for the young child. And when you have found him, bring back word to me that I may come and worship him also. Herod was trying to figure out a way to find where Jesus was because his desire was to kill him. But in Matthew 2:9, King James Version, it says, when they have heard the king, they departed, and behold the star which they've seen in the east, that they had followed from far, far away. It went before them, till it came and it stood over where the young child was. And then listen to these words in Matthew 2:10. When they saw that the star had stood still, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy because that star led them into the presence of Jesus. I don't care how hard the journey was. I don't care how far you've traveled from. The Bible says that if you will follow the signs that God has laid in your life, God is leading you into the presence of Jesus because in his presence there is fullness of joy. Joy will flood your life when you open your life to the reality of Jesus the Christ. And that is the message that we preach. He's come to fill your heart with joy. The Bible said they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy when they found the presence of God on earth. And they had come from far distances. And when they came and stood where Jesus was, they rejoiced greatly. When we consider this in the light of Luke chapter 1, we find this second truth, that those who listen to his voice, those who obey his commandments and listen to his voice, they will be filled with joy. It says, now Mary, in verses 39 to 45, she arose in those days. She wanted to see about Elizabeth because she was given a promise, and she wanted to know if the promise would stand, whether she will conceive and bring forth God's son into the world. So she went because Elizabeth was already showing. And the Bible said that when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, not the other way around, when Elizabeth heard the voice of Mary, that the babe, that's John, leaped in her womb. This is John the Baptist, and she was filled with the Holy Spirit. This unborn child, say with me what? unborn child. Isn't it amazing how people would like to relegate the fetus to everything else? But the Bible is saying that John the Baptist at 6 months, say with me what? 6 months, has the ability, because he's a human being, to be filled and experience the Spirit of God. He has the ability to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit of God as an unborn child. And God says this even of Jeremiah. He says, when you were in the womb, I knew you. And there are some of you that God knew you before you were born. Hallelujah. God came and abode with you in the womb. Your parents knew you were special because they said, this child, from the time you were in the belly, he acted strange, because the anointing of God was on your life for purpose. Can someone give God praise? And the Bible says, and his purposes will never be denied. This unusual child began to leap and dance. Joyful dance. Say with me what? Joyful dance. I believe that John the Baptist break out a moonwalk, and he was filled with joy when Elizabeth came into the presence of Jesus Christ. There's so many things that are possible. Then Elizabeth spoke with a loud voice, and she declared, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. But why is this granted to me, that the mother of my Lord, the mother of Jesus, would come to me? For indeed, as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. He was in the presence of Jesus, and John the Baptist, unborn, experiences what? Joy. Mary comes into the presence of Elizabeth, and John, an unborn baby, in the presence of Jesus, experiences joy. Here's what I'm going to say to you. If John the Baptist, an unborn, six-month-old baby, can experience joy in the womb, the Lord Jesus Christ's presence in your life today will change everything and allow you to experience his joy. If you believe that, give the Lord a hand. Hallelujah. If you believe that, give the Lord a hand. The presence of Jesus makes all the difference in the world. You have to believe that. I'm going to ask you to practice inviting Jesus into your heart, but practice inviting him into your mind, to your mind. Many of you know that Jesus can have your heart, but he doesn't occupy your mind, because your mind is filled with bad thoughts. Do you know your mind wrestles with your heart? Because the heart may already believe, but the mind negates everything that the heart believes. Talks it out of every blessing, fills it with bad thoughts, and preoccupy your mind with worry, doubt, fear, and evil. And the mind needs to come into the presence of Jesus. But I also say to you to invite the presence of Jesus into your home. Where? Into your home. It's good that you can come and meet Jesus at church, but this same Jesus will follow you home, and you can invite the presence of Jesus into your home. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name forever. Blessed be his name forever. And in your house, say in my house, there will be joy. Yes, there will be joy. Because you believe it and you are brave enough to declare it. God came to give us something that goes beyond what humanity could ever comprehend. And that is the gift of salvation. This is why Isaiah prophesied and says in Isaiah 61 and 10, I'm overwhelmed with joy in the Lord my God, for he has dressed me in the clothing of salvation. Do you see that? Maybe you've been in and out of church for a long time, but rather than be filled with joy, you're sitting here today and you find yourselves overwhelmingly sorrowful. You're thinking, Pastor Carl, that's a great word, but I want to believe so bad. Because today, as I listen to your voice, what I'm experiencing is pain. Pain from rejection, pain from loss, pain from so many things that is going on in my life that you cannot comprehend. My heart hurts. I'm experiencing grief. But you're saying that Jesus wants me to have joy. He wants you to experience his salvation above all else. And he wants you as a child of God. He wants your heart and your life to be filled with the expression of joy. Your heart may be heavy. You may be having a sense of loneliness, slight despair, and you may believe that no one cares. You know, the world has not changed. We live in a world that seems not to care when you're going through your darkest days. It's amazing that the world becomes silent. They don't know what to say. Somehow they don't know how to respond to us in our deepest pain. And the world comes off as uncaring. David says, no man cares for my soul. You may believe that no one cares. But Isaiah tells you that Jesus will clothe you with salvation and he will give you the blessing of overwhelming joy. That he will take these things from you if you will let him. Jeremiah says this. He says, then you will call upon me. Jeremiah 29, 12 and 13. And come and pray to me. And Jesus said, I will listen to you. You will seek me and you will find me when you search for me with all your heart. Here is why. The reason that Jesus responds differently than anyone else is because he's been where you are. Are you hearing me? He's been where you are, and there are scriptures that proves it. I want to show you that when you're feeling like no one cares with what you're going through, that Jesus cares. That he understands more than you know. In Hebrews 4:15, would you turn there with me as we get ready to close? He says, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings. Say with me, feelings, feelings. He's not talking about your actual situation. He's talking about what you feel about what you're going through. Jesus can be touched with your feelings. Hallelujah. I felt that because there's so many people said, nobody understands what I'm going through, Pastor. That's a good, strong word, Pastor, but nobody feels what I'm feeling. The Bible says you have a high priest. His name is Jesus. And you can touch and move his heart with compassion because he feels what you feel. Blessed be your name. He feels it in the depths of his being from every infirmity that walks upon the face of the earth. Hebrews 4:15 is saying, and he's using it in the counter sense because he's reminding us that we have a high priest who can be touched. I've come today to tell you that Jesus can be touched. Jesus can be touched with what you're feeling. He can be touched with the pain of what you're going through because he knows the infirmities that has come upon every man because he was in all points faced with those situations and tempted like we are, yet he did not sin. Jesus today is moved with compassion for you and for me when we grieve because he shares our experiences. Could you say with me, he shares your experience. He shares your experience. It doesn't make him act out. It doesn't make him get angry. It doesn't make him sin. But he shares your experiences. He shares your experiences so he can know. And that's why he says he will not put more on us than we can bear. How does he know what you can bear? Because he feels what you're feeling. He knows when life is pushing you to your breaking point, when life is bringing you to the precipice and to the edge of the grave, yet he will not let you slip or fall into a pit. Will not let you slip or fall into a pit. He said, I will not let you bear more than you can carry. But with every situation, he said, I've planned your escape. You know why you've gotten this far? You've gotten this far because while you have been lamenting what you've been going through, the God who refuses to give up on you has been planning your escape. When you've been writing life off, he's never stopped thinking about where you feel trapped and stuck. He's been planning your escape. He's like MacGyver. He's refusing to write you off because he feels what you're feeling. He knows the infirmities that you're going through. People say Jesus was never married, but he knows. He knows what it feels to be rejected. He knows what it feels to be hurt and to be disappointed. He knows what it feels to be betrayed. He knows. 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 You know how I know he knows? Because Isaiah 53 and 3 tells us he was despised. He was rejected. I want you to look at the next statement of words. He was a man of sorrows. That's pure. Not just a man of sorrow, meaning the cross. It says of our Lord Jesus Christ, God the Son in the flesh, he was a man of sorrows. Sometimes I feel life is hard on me. Sometimes I feel like life should exclude me. Sometimes I feel like, God, you're allowing more to happen to me than I deserve. I've walked before you in integrity of my heart. But when I read that, I apologize. I asked God to forgive me because Jesus was a man, was acquainted with sorrows. He was a man of sorrows. A man of sorrows. And he was acquainted with the deepest grief. And as he is experiencing that, the Bible says, and the world has not changed. We turned our backs on him. And we looked the other way. He was despised and we did not care. He was despised and we did not care. Does Jesus identify where you are? Yes, he does. Because he, a man acquainted with sorrows and our deepest grief, when people should have cared, they turned their back on him. They looked the other way. They did not care. And that is why Jesus takes a different position in response to the sorrows of our lives. And that's why with open arms he says, cast all your cares on me. Put it on me. Put it on me. I care for you. Woo! Glory to God. I feel a healing Jesus in this room. I feel the power of Yeshua in the room. I feel the release of the Spirit in the room. Hallelujah. I feel the flow of the river of God that brings healing and release to the soul that is troubled and burdened and broken and bruised, because he's that kind of God. He identifies where you are. He's acquainted with the grief that's upon your life. He knows that people don't care, but he cares. Could you say with me, he cares, he cares. Whoa, look up, he cares. Woo. Nobody's come to look for me after I lost. Nobody, but he cares, hallelujah. He never left me, he never abandoned me. He walked with me. He was acquainted with my sorrow and my grief. He understood my pain because he was where I am at. He sits right where you are. But he just doesn't sit there. He's come to do something about you. And he's inviting you with all your worries and all your pain and all your loss. He says, give it to me. To do what with it? Give it to me. Let me give you my everlasting joy. How many of you would like to experience the joy of God today? How many of you would like to experience the joy of God? Isaiah 61, 1-3, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, speaking about the Lord Jesus Christ, for the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He sent me to comfort the brokenhearted, to proclaim that captives will be released, prisoners will be free. He sent me to tell those who mourn that the time of the Lord's favor has come, and with it the day of God's anger against our enemies. To all who mourn in Israel, to all who mourn in Living Hope Cathedral, to all who mourn in the United States Virgin Islands, who feels empty, who feels sad, who feels alone, to all who mourn, he says, I will give you a crown of beauty for ashes in exchange, a joyous blessing instead of mourning in exchange. Festive praise instead of despair in exchange. Jesus came. And he's saying to you today that if you will give what you're carrying to me, I will give you what I have. Jesus came so we wouldn't have to live burdened by sadness and grief and loss. He came so that you can live in joy. If you're here today or listening in the comfort of your home, through Facebook Live, later on through YouTube, even through the pandemic, faith has a response. Faith has a response. I may not be able to touch you. I may not be able, like before, to have you come in these altars and aisles and weep over you and hug you and pray for you and speak in my heavenly language over your life. But God can touch you where you are. God can touch you where you are. Because there's no limitation to this omnipresent God who's available to you where you are. Glory to God. And the Bible said he sent his word and he healed him. He sent his word and he healed him. He sent his word and he healed him. Blessed be his name forever. Glory to God. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Sister Kendra, could you come? He sent his word and he healed him. And I believe that God is going to do that miracle of healing in your life and your heart by faith. I believe it so much that I've asked Sister Kendra to come because she's going to pray over your life with the anointing and the spirit of intercession that's upon her. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and he said, I will wipe every tear from your eye. There will be no more death. There will be no more sorrow. There will be no more crying, and there will be an end to pain. All these things are gone forever. And the one who sits on the throne, our Lord Jesus Christ, said, look, I am making everything new. I am making everything new. If you're here today under the sound of my voice and you want God to begin to revolutionize your life, want you God to fill your life with joy, to take away your pain and your grief, could you stand and get ready? Give the Lord a hand as people are standing all over this room. Sister Kendra, lead us into a season of prayer. Father, we bless your name. Glory to God. We bless your name. We bless your name. We bless your name, Jesus. Glory to God. There's a sweet aroma of your presence. Hallelujah. Amen. Over your people, over our lives. We give you praise and glory.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you for your word.
And I just want to share. I'm just led to share this. The night before I was diagnosed with COVID, I told my husband, I don't feel good in my body. And he said, no, it's in your mind. But I knew something was shifting in my body. So the Spirit took me to Psalm 89. And I began to meditate on this word. And I'm going to share it with you. I have found my servant David. But I found myself erasing David's name and putting my name. I have found my servant Kendra. With my holy oil, I have anointed her. With whom my hand shall be established. Also my arm shall strengthen her. The enemy shall not outwit her, nor the son of wickedness afflict her. I will beat down her foes before her face and plague those who hate her. But my faithfulness and my mercy shall be with her. And in my name, her horn shall be exalted. So I didn't understand horn. What is a horn? So I looked it up. And a horn pressed down are enemies, that pastor called reference, right? Enemies, spiritual enemies, the enemy of sickness, the enemy of disease, the enemy of lack, the enemy of failure, the enemy of defeat, the enemy of doubt, and the enemy of limitation. So what is the opposite of those things? What is a horn exalted? Well, I'm glad you asked. A horn exalted represents liberty, because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. A horn exalted is victory. A horn exalted is triumph. A horn exalted is strength. A horn exalted is health. A horn exalted is hope. A horn exalted is joy. And a horn exalted is faith. Do we have any horns in this house this morning?
Oh, Father, we give you praise. We thank you for the horn that you have exalted in our lives. And we claim your promise. And that was the scripture that I held on to. And when I begin to meditate, the Spirit of God renewed my strength. Renewed my strength. And that is my encouragement. Find a word that you can hold on to, that even in the face of COVID, even in the face of lack, even in the face of unemployment, even in the face of rejection, guess what God is promising us today? That his oil of joy will be given in exchange for mourning. So we are going to pray. We are going to intercede on behalf of others who so desperately need the same hope that we all who are believers hope in. The scripture says hope deferred makes the heart sick. Oh, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. So we are going to give God praise. And in this moment, I want us to begin to silently praise and worship God for who he is. He is a deliverer. He is a healer. So, Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for who you are to us. Your word is spirit and it is life. And we thank you for who you are to us. You said that the scriptures will be manifested to those who believe. So we give you praise. We thank you, oh God, because you are the God of the impossible. Nothing is impossible with you. You said for men, things are impossible, but with God, all things are possible. So Father, in this moment, we thank you even now for your promise that you will beat down every enemy that comes against your children. Father, we thank you that you said that you have maintained our lot. The lines have fallen for your children in pleasant places. We have a good inheritance. So we stand on your word, oh God. We thank you that your word will not return unto you void, but it will establish that in which it has been sent. So Father, even now, for those who are sick in their bodies, we thank you, oh God, that the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is able to deliver and rescue by the power of your spirit. We thank you, oh God, that healing is flowing now from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet. We thank you, oh God, that they are already clean because of the words that has been sent. We thank you. We send forth your word to heal every affliction, to heal every disease, because you are the Lord, our healer. Can we declare that the Lord is our healer? The Lord is our healer. Father, you said that you will be our shade upon our right hand. The sun shall not smite us by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve us from all evil. You shall preserve our souls. You will preserve us in our going out, in our coming in, and this time forth, and even forever. And Father, we lift up those who may be discouraged. Oh, Father, we thank you for your word that soothes, that heals, that strengthens. So we pray for strength in their inner man now. We declare that the joy of the Lord is their strength. In Jesus' name, we thank you, oh God, for your healing. We thank you that you will wrap us with your love. We thank you even now for the wall of fire that you have said will always be protecting us. And we thank you that your glory will continue to be in our midst. That is what your promise is to your children. So we receive them today in Jesus' name. And we are just going to say some declarations. But I want you to open your mouth and give God praise. He said, let my people praise you. Let my people praise you. And the earth shall yield its increase unto us. That is some of the reasons why we are not getting increases. Because we are keeping our mouth shut. Open your mouth and give God praise. Oh, you are worthy. Let my people praise me. Oh, open your mouth. He is worthy. are worthy. You are worthy. Let my people praise me. Hallelujah. You have been a good God. You have been a good God. Yes. You are worthy. Hallelujah. Yay. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh, we will not let the rocks and the stones cry out for us. You are worthy. You are indeed worthy to receive glory and honor and power for now and forever. Oh, we lose the chains of wickedness. We lose the chains of wickedness. We lose the chains of wickedness. Now, in the name of Jesus, Shehe, Rihekete, Shehenimo, give God praise. You don't know what he's protecting you from. Give him praise. He is worthy. Hallelujah. Oh. Hallelujah. Oh, we will not be silent. We will not be silent. 2020 is not going to keep us silent. You are worthy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. Oh. There's not enough time in the day to worship God. Oh, hallelujah. Let me tell you, I was in Revelation 4, and John, when he was describing what he was seeing in heaven, oh, he said he saw the throne, and it was beautiful in all its splendor. And then he said he saw 24 elders, and they were around the throne room. Oh, glory to God. And he said that there were four creatures. Oh, they had eyes all around, and they had wings. There was one that was described as an eagle. There was one described as a lion. There was one that had the face of a man. They would look at the throne day and night, no stop, and they would worship God. And when the 24 elders saw that, they casted their crowns at his feet, and they sang, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the one who was and is to come." This is Christmas. This is the reason why he came. He deserves worship. And we're not going to scream right now, but we're just going to give God that soft worship. Connect your heart to heaven. He deserves it. He deserves it. Give us something, Derek, nice and soft. I want everyone's hands to be lifted. This is a moment of breakthrough. Oh. Our situations are not bigger than our God. Can we just give God an offering of praise? Slowly, gently. Oh, Lord, you are worthy. You are deserving of every good thing. Everything that our lips utter. May it bring you praise. May it come up to you like a sweet smelling aroma. Oh, Father, we give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory in Jesus' name. And even now, we decree and declare that the God of hope will fill us all with joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope by the power of the Spirit. We decree and declare that you are our portion. And we thank you, O God, that you maintain our lot. And the lines have fallen for us in pleasant places. So even now in this moment, increase our faith to believe the impossible, to believe that tomorrow is better than today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yes, bask in his presence.
Lovers of your presence.
Yes.
Lovers of your presence.
Yes, let God sing over us this morning. Just as Pastor Gall said, he wants to do that. Let him pour his love on you in this season. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Let's sing.
Church and on our lives. We thank you for hearing our prayers. We thank you for responding. We thank you for caring more than we can ever know or imagine. We thank you for healing our hearts and overwhelming us with your peace and your everlasting joy. I pray that joy will be the mark of our lives from this day forward. In the mighty name of your Son Jesus, we pray. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. So we've been going back and forth debating with myself, but we've decided, and it's been confirmed today by this message, that we will greet 2021 with a shout. Glory to God, we will. I hear the shout. As Kendra was prophesying, I started praising God. I hear the shout of victory among the righteous. Hallelujah. Could you give the Lord a hand? That's an amazing thing. I want you to look it up. I hear the shout of victory among the righteous. And I want you to look at your neighbor through your mask and say, that's me. That's me. Not only am I still dancing, but I'm still warring, and I'm still believing, and I'm still dancing. Amen. And I remember the Hebrew boys, where they make the furnace 10 times hotter because the desire was for them to perish, and they threw them bound into the fire. Are you hearing me? And when Nebuchadnezzar came to see their demise, because he ordered it, he was stunned. He thought he was drunk. He saw men walking free, walking in the midst of the fire. And I say to you that God has freed our hands for war. Glory to God. Amen. You may have been bound up, but God has freed your hands. And this is how we walk. Raise your hands. This is how we walk. This is how we walk. This is how we walk. It seems like craziness until you get it. I'm going to tell you, when some of you come into that place of praise and God began to revolutionize your life, I will not be able to keep you quiet, because this is how we walk. Hallelujah. This is how we walk. Hey, I come into the sanctuary for war. This is how we walk. Blessed be his name forever. Glory to God. And only 100 people can fill this auditorium. So if you want to look nice with your little champagne glass, you can watch us on Facebook Live. But the worshipers, I want you in the house. I want the people who come to dance. I want you in the house. I want you who come to make noise. I want you in the house. Hallelujah. Hey, glory to God. I feel a shout already. I feel winning already. I feel victory coming upon me. Hey, I feel it in my spirit. And that's what David said, and I'm releasing you. 2020 came to silence me, but I'm still shouting. Glory to God. It came to make me shut up, but there is a noise in me. Hey, there's a noise in me. There's a noise in me. Hallelujah. There's a noise in me. I hear those who don't understand saying to me, blind Bartimaeus, shut up. But I know Jesus is here. And he cried out the more. Hey! He cried out the more. Hey! That's what I feel on it. Are you hearing me? Blind Bartimaeus knew that Jesus was near. And he will not leave without the blessing. Understand? You make me act decent and in order is going to make me miss my blessing. You making me shut up is going to make me miss my blessing. You asking me not to dance is going to make me miss my blessing. I have worked too hard to get this close to Jesus and be silent. I feel a sound. Hey, I feel a sound. Glory to God. Yes, I feel a sound. And hell must be nervous, because hell came at me and I'm still shouting. Hell gotta be nervous. I mean, he threw the best he had at us. Wave with me. Look at me. I'm still shouting. I'm still shouting. I'm still praising. I'm still giving honor, God, the glory and the honor that is due to his name. I want you to get lots of rest. If you get released half day, go to bed. Get some rest. Get your white clothes ready. I don't promise you they're going to be white when you leave, but get your white clothes ready. And we are coming into the house to sing and make declaration. Not about 2021, but about our God. About whom? Our God. And he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Blessed be his name. Glory to God. Now lift up your hands. I want to bless you. And now I'm with the grace, the anointing, the favor, the power of God. Yes, be activated in your life. May he overwhelm you with joy. Hallelujah. I just don't want you to get excited when you're here, but I want you to be excited in your cars. I want you to be excited on your jobs. I want you to be excited in your families. I want you to be excited upon your beds. Woo. I want you to be excited getting up and lying down. sitting down to eat or exercising. May the joy of the eternal God be yours, be yours, be yours. Hallelujah. May he satisfy your mouth with good things. With good things. Hallelujah. May he furnish a table for you. Hallelujah. I'm prophesying. Lift up your hand if you're going to receive it. May he furnish a table for you in the presence of your enemies. I pray that he will pour on your life his anointing oil and let your cup run over in Jesus' mighty name. He says, you shall lend and not borrow. You are the head and not the tail. You are above only and not beneath. And the glory and the favor of God is yours now and always. Yes, and God's people say, amen and amen and amen. So let it be. The Lord loves you. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you. And may he grant you peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. And all God's people say, amen.